Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Friday writing workshop. I'm joined again by Neeraj. Hello, Neeraj.
Hello, Neil, and hello to everybody who's joined us.
He's just adjusting his camera to look his absolute best. You know, I have a very big head, so it fills a lot of the space, so we have to kind of balance it up. Maybe I'll move back a little so our head looks humanly the same size. Anyway, we're here today, as every week, to help you with skills aimed at tests and exams like IELTS or Cambridge exams. And today we're going to talk about writing. And Neeraj is going to tell us a little bit more about what we're going to be looking at.
Today's objective is to think about how to write an essay, which is kind of writing that I'm sure everybody has had some experience with at some point at school or at university, in their own language or in English, I'm sure. It's a typical writing task that teachers often give to people, but it's also a very common writing task type that you will find in English language exams like IELTS. And in fact, it is one of the obligatory tasks in the IELTS writing exam. So we're going to think about how to interpret a question and how to think about planning your answer for a really good essay.
Mm-hmm. So I've just put up on the screen, the menu of what we're going to talk about today. So we're going to start by talking about the importance of planning. Then we're going to look at different question types and analyzing the question and how you can be sure you answer it, you know, fully and appropriately. Then we're going to take you through the steps that we would recommend you to go through in coming up with a perfect plan. Let's aim high, a perfect plan for your essay. We'll give you some practice in that. We'll ask you to write some sentences and to share your ideas. And then at the end, hopefully, you'll be able to write not a full paragraph. We're not going to ask you to do too much, but, you know, to maybe write some and maybe make some points and you know, give you a chance to practice the writing, and we'll give you some feedback on those. And then we'll finish up with some tips to remember. Okay, just a few things before we start. We've got lots of people joining us from all over, so I'm just going to give a quick shout out to some of the countries that we've got, from Azerbaijan, Egypt, Iraq, Mexico, Georgia, Ukraine, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Vietnam, Colombia, Argentina, and lots more. That's great. So always nice to see people here from all over the world in different countries. Keep telling us that. It's nice to know. Italy's just popped up there as well, so lots more. So you were talking about this being an important part of many tests. Just before we begin, and before we begin looking at, you know, a question, a type of question, and talking about that, what are some of the things that people sometimes do wrong? Why do people sometimes not get the result that they want in writing essays?
Yes, I think there's a few reasons. One of them, which I see quite often, especially with my students where I work here in Spain, in Barcelona, it's that people rush into writing an essay without taking time to stop and think about the ideas that they want to write about and to organize it. And so they just start writing immediately and they perhaps fill up a page, but it's as if you're kind of reading what's going on in their brain exactly. You know, you're reading what we call in English a stream of consciousness. So it's like their thoughts exactly word for word going along like a train without stopping and without kind of being organized in a particular way. And so it feels like you're reading that, and that's quite difficult to read because there's quite often there's no structure, as I said before, and very often it doesn't answer the exact question that the examiner's asking you to answer. So that's a really big problem.
And that's the problem that we're going to address today. And hopefully by the end of today, we'll have helped people to move towards at least not making that mistake. Lots more countries joining us, from Indonesia, Jordan, Ethiopia, Someone else, Fernando's in Barcelona. They're saying hi.
Hello,
to you.
Fernando. I think we had Fernando last week. Hello, Fernando, again.
Bhutan, Venezuela, Philippines, and lots more. Peru as well, there at the end from Miguel. Great. Somalia. We have everywhere. Okay, so to get started, we're going to have a look at a typical IELTS question, and we're just going to look at the question first, and look at what it says and what it asks you, and talk about that, and you know the type of question that it is. But I'm going to put it up now because we're going to look at this question all through this session, so it's good for you to start thinking about it right away when we come up with this. So let me just put that in place. Okay. So Neeraj, would you like to talk through this a little?
Yeah, and it's funny because it's something that I've been thinking about quite a lot recently. I actually went to a British Council training session for teachers all about this. And I actually have a personal example, which I'll explain in a moment, of how this is very important to my son as well. I'll explain more in a second. Shall I read the question?
Yeah, why not?
Has been said that advances in modern technology and AI, artificial intelligence, will soon mean that human teachers in school classrooms will become unnecessary. In your opinion, would this be a positive development? Give reasons for your answer and include any relevant examples from your own knowledge or experience.
Okay, now, just to be clear for people watching, we're not asking you to answer this question yet or to do anything with it. We're going to come to that quite soon. We're going to talk about a little bit about, you know, this type of question, and you know, we're going to talk about what it involves and what you have to think about before we then move on and look at it in more detail. So what would you say, Neeraj, about this?
Yeah.
Question type, let's talk about
it. Yes, question type, that's it. Because there's, in the IELTS exam, there's a few different styles of essay questions that you could get. For example, I think most people should be familiar with the type of question where you're asked to look at advantages versus disadvantages of some problem or some issue. And then there's another question type where you're asked to consider two viewpoints. People think this, people think that. Consider both. And there's a few other question types, but this one, it's also another common question type, which is there's a situation presented to you, and what's your opinion about this situation? Is it good? Is it bad? That's basically the type of question.
And these are usually situations that are, well, I don't know about controversial, but situations where people can perhaps have stronger feelings one way or the other for that. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So for everyone watching, this is just the question, the example. We're going to come back to this. We're going to ask you lots of detailed questions about this. We're going to work through it. And at the end, we'll have a plan. You'll have a plan and you'll be able to do some writing. But for the moment, that's the question. We've looked at it. Now, our question to you is this. Tell us about your experience. When you have to write an essay for an English test, whether it's IELTS or Cambridge test or a test at your university or school, whatever, when you have to write, and not just essays, but I mean, you know, in general, any writing that you have to do, do you plan your writing before you begin it? Or do you just sit down, think, okay, this is what I want to say, and then start typing? Tell us in the comments. What about you, Neeraj? Are you a planner or a typer?
A bit of both, to be honest. It depends on what I'm writing. If it's something shorter, then I'll just start writing, especially on the computer. And if I see I don't like it, I'll start editing and making changes. Longer bits of text, then I'll make a skeleton plan and I'll start building things around the plan. But when I remember when I was a student at school, I was terrible at writing essays. And I just used to have the habit of diving straight into writing the essay.
I could write quite a lot.
But then I'd get my essay back from the teacher and he'd say, or she'd say, sorry, this is all completely irrelevant. But I poured my heart and soul into this essay.
Did she write that in red pen or green pen?
Yeah, no, I wish they'd had green pens there. It would have been a bit less threatening, but no, it was always a red pen.
Right. Okay. So I should say to people before we go any further, I'm really happy that everyone is using the word typer there, but I should explain that I just made that word up. It doesn't really exist in English. Technically, someone who types is a typist, but you know, you can add er to any word to say someone that does it because English is a flexible language. But yeah. So Libera Maria Lai saying typer, Yuki as well, typer. Anil is saying planning beforehand is always better. That's a good answer, Anil, but it's like a lawyer's answer. It's like you're saying it's better, but you didn't tell us if you do it or not. So that's a good thing. Okay. Alicia is saying, yeah, I have to think and write a draft first. Okay. That's another way, I guess, of doing it. Just still not planning, but writing a draft, then redrafting. Okay. Nguyen is saying I need to plan some main ideas. Deepti, yes, I do a draft first. Sometimes I think I plan too much. Let's just talk about that for a minute, Neeraj. What do you think? Is it possible to plan too much?
I think so. It's a good point. I have to agree with Deepti that there are some people that do plan too much, because in an exam situation, you're under time pressure, yeah, and you really need to draw a line at a certain moment and say, that's enough planning. I need to start writing now. If you've got lots of time and there's no time limit, then yeah, you can plan for weeks, you know, if you've got a longer text that you need to hand in to a teacher in a month's time, then yeah, you can take more time. But in an exam, there needs to be a limit.
Okay. Give me just 1 second. I think. Okay, sorry about this. Just 1 second. Right. We've got lots more answers here. Beatrice is saying, I normally plan what I want to write. I really like to have a structure. Juana is a planner as well. April saying I jot down some outlines before I start to write. And Heba's come up with, I think, one of your favorite expressions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that old chestnut. You fail to plan, you plan to fail.
Yep,
it's lovely.
It's true. I mean, you know, it is. It's a very popular saying, but it's...
I was going to do my best not to say that today, because see how long it took for somebody to come out with it.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And just take a couple more answers from people. Okay, from Nasi, it's got a point here. I plan it too, but my plan for the point and idea is not good or sometimes not relevant at all. Mm-hmm. So that's a really good comment there from Nasi as well. I mean, I've seen this with my students as well. You know, when I first encourage them to plan, they do a plan. They go through the steps, through the motions of a plan, and they have the notes. But it's not really a plan because they, you know, they need to learn how to make a plan that actually works for them. What would you say about that?
That's right. I agree. You see some plans which are basically like shopping lists of words that they might like to include in the essay. And that's not really a plan. That helps you to think about the structure and think about the building paragraphs around certain ideas. So hopefully today we're going to show you how to really use a good plan.
Okay. One last comment and then we'll move on. You know, because we seem to have a mix today, which is good. We have a mix of people that start writing straight away, people that do a draft and then revise it, and then I think more than half of the answers so far say they make a plan, and then there's people like Nasiet who says they make a plan but they're not really happy with their plan. One last one from Julia here saying, I have to brainstorm a bit in order to create ideas and I can have a fertile and productive writing essay. So we're going to come to that in a little bit too. Let's move on. So let's go back to our question, just to remind people and to refresh their memory of what it was about. So it's been said that advances in modern... Oops, sorry. I don't know how that happened. It's been said that advances in modern technology and AI will soon mean that human teachers in school classrooms will become unnecessary. In your opinion, would this be a positive development? Okay. So my first step here would always be, before we start writing anything or thinking about anything with my students, I would ask them, you know, how do you feel about this? What do you think? What is your opinion? What would you say, Neeraj?
Yes. In terms of the opinion, mm-hmm. it's if you look at the question there, is it a positive development or not? You can either say yes, you agree that it's a positive development, no, it's not a positive development, or you might be somewhere in the middle. It depends.
Mm. Yeah.
And for these essays, it doesn't matter from the examiner's perspective if you're in the no team or the yes team or in the middle team, but you do need to say it clearly at some point in the essay and then support that.
Right. We're going to come back and look at that in a bit more detail in a moment. But the question that we're going to ask everybody is just that at the beginning here. Okay. But I guess before we go to that, would you like to say a little bit more about the question, about breaking down the question?
When you come to writing an essay, the first thing that you want to do is understand the question and analyze it for two things. We want to take out from the question what's the two T's, I call them, the topic and the task. Let's think about the topic first. So the word topic means the subject, the area that we're going to write about. And I always ask my students to underline the keywords in the question that could indicate mm-hmm. the topic. So our task for you mm-hmm. would be to identify which words in the question indicate the topic,
yeah,
the subject area we're going to write about. Which words would you underline in this question?
Okay. So let's see what people are saying. So we're looking here for basically keywords. So let's look at it in two parts, because you've got the statement at the beginning, then you've got the question in the second part. So let's look at the statement first. What, just if you had to take out all the words that are not essential here and just focus on the keywords that would be like a note to help you to think about what you're going to be talking about, what would they be? We can help them, I guess, with maybe the first one.
Yeah. I would mark modern technology.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we've got some examples coming in now. Okay, there we go. So we've got AI, human teachers unnecessary. Yep. And Alisa, the same. AI, teachers unnecessary.
Okay, yep. Great. They've yep. got the topic.
That's really your focus. Yep. Nasiet saying technology and AI. Yes, you're right. I mean, it does have both. It doesn't only mention AI. It also mentions modern technology. So perhaps there are other things that you could
mention. Let's say cameras and recorders and maybe laptops, all that kind of stuff, all the different devices, the hardware that we use in technology in education.
Yes. So this is going great. Anna Zablova as well. AI, human teachers, modern technology. I think the one thing that you're missing there, Anna, is the unnecessary. The very, very important one for that. Again, AI, teachers, unnecessary. That's basically the core, the heart of the issue of what we're looking at here.
That's right. Okay. This would be the topic of the question, the subject area.
Mm-hmm. So that's the statement at the beginning. Let's talk now about much shorter, the actual task that is there. Very simple.
So remember I said before the two T's, we've talked about the topic, now we're on to the task. The task is the focus or the direction we should we should go in, and that's contained in the question. Is your in your opinion, would this be a positive development? And again, what would be the key words there to identify the task, the specific objective in the essay? What do we have to do in this essay? We know what we're going to talk about, but what's the focus? How do we have to, what's the objective in the essay? What keywords would you mark?
Okay, no answers coming in for this one just yet. But
Alicia Wasserman's got something there.
Okay, got one there, Alicia, yes. Uh-huh. Your opinion, positive, yeah, positive. I think you'd have to keep positive and development together, really, for that. Okay, so that's it. It's just, yeah, so your opinion and positive development. And that's basically it. That's so...
As maybe a question mark at the end there as well, positive development.
Question mark. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there we go. And yeah, more are coming in now. Okay, great. Exactly. So that's what we're focused on. So we're focused on, as Neeraj says, the topic, advances in technology and AI, teachers unnecessary. Done. Your opinion, is it positive? That's it. That's what we've got to address in our answer. Okay, so let's move on. And we've looked at this for a while now. I think everyone can see the question and is familiar with the topic that we're looking at. So let's ask the question first. We're not asking you to write an essay here. We're not asking you to write a paragraph or anything. Yeah. We're just asking, what is your opinion? How do you feel about the statement? It asked you, you know, in your opinion, is it a positive development? Okay. Tell us your opinion. Yes, no, maybe. And of course, maybe a few words to tell us why you feel that way. And that's basically it. Okay. Mohammed's straight out of the gate there with it's a positive, or I'm not sure, he's got a question mark at the end. So a positive development question mark. Okay, that's an answer to the previous question, I guess. Yes. Okay. Now, Alicia Wasserman, this is interesting. Alicia said, I don't agree. Now, it's expressing an opinion, but what would you say about that in this context?
Well, she's saying, I don't agree. And I understand it to mean that it's she doesn't agree that it's a positive development. So she's basically saying no.
Yeah.
She hasn't said why. Mm-hmm. So it'd be interesting to know why not.
Okay. Beatrice has written quite a long answer here, but that's great. Great to see. I strongly disagree because we need human interaction to share knowledge with the others. Technology should just be a tool to help us automate routine, repetitive tasks. Mm-hmm. Okay. Some excellent points there. Keep them in mind. You'll need them later as we move on. But that's very clear. So strongly disagree. You know, it's a definite position.
Yeah. And I think so many people out there would say the same thing as Beatrice. They would feel a very similar way. She recognizes that there's a use for some of the tools there, but mm-hmm. there's a limit. Yeah.
Libera is saying yes, because yes, it's a positive development because mm-hmm. the workload of teachers will be reduced. I like that thinking, Libera, I guess.
I hope that's true.
Elisa's in the middle, I think, saying a mixture is probably the best solution. So a mixture of AI and technology and face-to-face teaching. April's come in again with a negative development. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now, here's a good example, I think, that you will have something to say about from Munir.
I believe that AI can be useful for finding scientific information in scientific sciences, but there is still an artistic and ethical part that AI cannot provide. That's an interesting point. Yeah. Okay. So... there is some truth to what Munir is saying.
Yeah.
But if I think, again, back to the question that mm-hmm. we had on the screen, which was about teaching and about a human teacher being in a classroom, is what Munir is saying relevant, related to exactly what we were saying in the question, what we were looking for in the question. Remember that we underlined topic words, which was human teachers, unnecessary due to technology. What Munir is saying, how relevant is that to those keywords that we underlined?
And this is a real danger, isn't it? Because it's possible to come up with some excellent ideas and excellent points and, you know, really good arguments about things. Yeah. But if they're not directly answering the question, remember, you're aiming for 250 words or so to write for this. So every word counts that you're working on for this. Mm-hmm. So, and time as well counts. So it's a good point, I think. You know, interesting points, but think about whether it actually specifically relates to the direct question that was asked there. Maher's got an opinion here as well. As a certified human teacher, absolutely not. Human interactions are far more qualitative and sensible than interacting with a machine. Okay. Darren's got a very strong opinion too. I like these strong opinions. Strong opinions make for really interesting, you know, points with this. And Darren's saying, too many people have a fear of technology and hate AI, which makes them look stupid. Okay. I might avoid look stupid in an IELTS answer. I don't know. What would you say? But the point
is, and again, this is, I mean, people do feel like this, and I do think that Darren is onto something there. But coming back to the question and the words we underlined about education, how is this related exactly to education? We need to think about that as well.
Okay, there are lots of great answers here, but we don't have time to look at them all. We'll look at them later and give some comments on those. MMKH has made an interesting point. I believe that any judgment as early as this cannot be counted as a drawback or benefit. I think MMKH there is saying basically it's too soon to tell. It's too soon to have an opinion, which is an interesting point, I think. Okay. Right. Let's move on to our next stage. Bear with me for just one moment. We need a slightly different viewpoint now. Okay. Right. Before we go on and start the actual planning here, Neeraj, let's talk about why this whole process, everything we're talking about here, is important. I've put up, we have the band descriptors for band 6, band 7, and band 5. And we'll just quickly, you know, talk about that a little. We can have a quick look and you can talk about how this relates to what you're assessed for in, for example, the IELTS test.
That's right. Okay, what we're looking at is a document that IELTS examiners use to evaluate writing and decide what band score, what grade you're going to get on based on your writing. And if your writing matches these comments, these descriptors, then they can award you this band. Now, we started today's workshop by looking at a question and analyzing it and being quite strict about the words we focus on in the question. And the whole reason why we started in that way is because if you look at the first descriptor in here, in the band 6 grading for IELTS task achievement, it says the response focuses on the requirements of the task and an appropriate format is used. So the examiners are actively looking for you to satisfy the question requirements. If the question is saying, tell us your opinion about whether this is a positive development or not, and you start talking about something which is not relevant to that, well, you haven't satisfied the requirements of the task. So they can't give you a band 6. They'll have to look at the lower band and see if it satisfies that.
Right. So let's talk about what would happen. Sorry, this is a slightly different thing. I'm just going to move that down. Okay, so let's talk about what would happen if you don't do this. What, you know, let's talk about, let's say your target is band 7 or band six, let's say, or 6.5, whatever it is that, what would happen? What would prevent you from getting that in the context of the planning and the structure?
Imagine you don't take time to read the question and identify the task. Imagine you've identified the topic. You know you've got to write about artificial intelligence and teachers in the classroom, but you miss the part about whether it's a whether you agree with it being a positive development, and you just write about the advantages and disadvantages of artificial or using technology in the classroom, and you don't talk about whether you think it's a positive development in your opinion, then what you're writing is not going to be exactly relevant to what the question is asked for. And so the examiner is going to look at a lower band score to award you.
Okay. Okay, so we've talked enough about that. Let's move on to the practical part of this. So we've looked at the question. Everyone's expressed an opinion. We have a range of opinions. We've said, you know, we've had some people say that there are lots of positives in terms of helping reduce workload. We've had lots of people say negatives for various reasons. We've had some people say it's in the middle. We've had some people say it's too early to tell. Let's take a look at how we can build on some of these ideas. And we're going to take a look at some of the questions that you can ask yourself. So let's just put this up. Okay. Okay, I'm sorry. Bear with me. Oh, is this, it's not my day. It's not moving. There we go. Finally. Okay. So, you know, we've had some ideas. People have made some statements already. They've said some things. It's not good because of this. It's not good. You know, it's good. This is something to think about. What's this about, the work questions that we're talking about here?
So most people have got an opinion one way or the other about this topic, and then maybe they've got one idea as to why they feel, yes, it's positive, or no, it's not positive, perhaps because of human interactions being better quality.
Yeah, we had that one, yes. Mm-hmm.
That's fair enough. That's a valid way to justify you thinking that it's not a good development, but it's not enough to build a paragraph around. Mm-hmm. You can't just write, I don't think it's positive because human interactions are much higher quality, full mm-hmm. stop. That's a paragraph. That's a sentence.
Yeah, it's the start of an idea. It's not the full idea developed and explained for why. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So to go further and develop the idea and build on it and really convince the reader or the examiner of your point, we need to interrogate the point and look at it from different perspectives. And the way to do that is by questioning it. And that's why we've put WH questions. What, why, who, when, where. For example, I think that artificial intelligence and modern technology is a positive development, and human teachers may be unnecessary in the future.
So you're struggling there. See, if this was your test, you'd be in trouble already.
Yeah. The next question is why? Mm-hmm. Why do I think so?
Mm-hmm. Okay, and we're going to go on, and basically what we're going to do is we're going to talk you through this, and we're going to help you to come up with your own ideas that you can then organize. But Muhammad's just agreeing with you there and saying, when we build any paragraph, we should need what? It's true. I mean, you know, and any paragraph is going to be answering those questions: why, who, what, when, where. You know, not even just in essays, but in journalism, in anything, you want to be able to work with that. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take you through a process of asking different questions to help you to come up with your own ideas and express your own ideas, which we can then try to bring together into a plan. So let's start with one. Okay, possible question to consider. Okay, simple place to start. What, you know, you want to talk about this one?
Yeah, so one one way to think about this, the question was talking about, will it be a positive development? We could also turn the question around a little bit and think, will technology replace teachers? Have you heard or do you know of any cases where this is possible, or some aspects of education where the technology has taken over the role of the teacher?
Mm-hmm.
I did mention earlier that my son has an experience of this, and he's actually learning to play the ukulele entirely through a tablet app.
Ah, okay. Uh-huh.
And he started from scratch, from the very beginning, and he's enjoying. My son's 8 years old, and he's just started to learn how to play chords, and it's all through an app. You get to watch videos, and the software listens to the way you play, and it tells you if you've played the correct note.
Fantastic.
Or not, and it's like a game, and he loves it. So is the technology replacing a teacher? Well, in his case, yes, because the tablet and the software is the teacher.
Mm-hmm. It's a great example, and I know. I mean, I've used those myself a lot for some, you know, advanced guitar things that I just, you know, even though I've played for years, I still couldn't get. And exactly, there are fantastic apps now that will take you through step by step for piano as well.
Yeah,
and you know, it's great. Okay. But I was going to say as well, you know, the original question, the original statement is kind of, it's an assumption in a way. It says many people believe, or people believe that AI will replace teachers. You don't have to accept that assumption, do you? I mean, you can ask yourself the question, well, is that true or is it not? And if it's not true, why not? And so let's take a look at what some people are saying about this before we go on and take a look at this. Darren's saying, no, AI can never replace smart teachers, but AI can replace those who teach by structured learning, which I guess is similar to perhaps the example you were looking at there. I mean, it's, you know, learning how to play chords on a ukulele is a kind of, you know, step-by-step physical activity that can be done without any other human being involved. Okay. Carmen is convinced that that yes, for sure, technology will replace teachers. So keep that in mind, Carmen, because next we're going to ask you about why. Why yes? Okay. So keep that in mind and think about your answers for that. So Alicia said, no, it can be useful, but it can't replace them. Now, again, let's, as Neeraj says, let's develop that further. Look at the next part where it says, okay, no, it can't replace them. That's a statement. But the question is, why not? Why can't it replace them? Okay.
That's it. WH questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's have a look. You know, again, Sawanda, same thing. We can't replace teachers. They're in our hearts, if you're lucky. So okay.
She's obviously had some very good teachers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, and Anna Zablova is saying language learning apps can replace teachers sometimes. Okay, again, that's good. We'll come to that in a moment. So if your answer is yes, then that's our next question to start thinking about that. But at the moment, we're still looking at the why, if not, why not? And a lot of people have said absolutely not, but I haven't seen too many examples yet of why not. What would you say, Neeraj? Have you seen many? I think
not yet.
Nope. I think it's mainly answering the first question, will technology replace teachers? And people are very fast to answer absolutely not.
Libera Maria Lai. I don't think teachers could be totally replaced by technology, because given the varied nature of the classroom, there is a need of something more than technology. It is called human touch.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I would maybe ask you to then go one step further and say, why is the human touch important? What does the human touch add to the experience of learning? You know, just think about that. Okay.
Yeah, what is it that a human teacher can do that a machine can't, that some software can't do? Why is the human touch necessary in education?
Okay, here's an answer from Leuda. computers can recognize some emotions, but not all. So, okay, so that's one aspect there. So empathy, I guess, and understanding and responding to emotions. Okay. Let's just see a couple more. Hold on. Alexander Vladimirov. Yeah, not for somebody else. Okay, so I would say that we're getting examples here very much of what we were talking about at the beginning, which is what we're trying to move past here, which is statements, but then not expanding on them. So let's move on to the next question to think about for people. Okay. Some people said yes. Okay, some people said yes, and a lot of people said yes, partly, not maybe 100%, but in some part. Okay, so let's look at that. What questions would you ask here then?
Well, I gave the example of a way that technology is replacing teachers, because I had the example really fresh in my head. I could ask myself, in which way is technology replacing teachers? Well, through apps on tablets, in particular. What form could that take? Well, software, which is like a game to teach children how to play musical instruments.
And this is an important part, isn't it? I mean, you know, when you're building your paragraph, when you're building your plan, it's not, you know, you've got your statement, your topic, you know, that you're saying there, but evidence, examples is something that you really want to put in it as well, isn't it? Like your example.
That's right. In the question itself, right at the bottom, it says there, please include any relevant examples and expand your point or explain your reasoning. Mm-hmm. And so if you have an example, either a real one, or it could be something that you've heard of through somebody else, you can use that in your essay.
I mean, Mohammed has said, yes, it will replace teachers. Artificial intelligence has become widespread today and everything. That's true, but that we're still only at the statement level of saying that's a fact, you know, that has become widespread, that is everywhere. But we need to go a little bit deeper and think, okay, what does that involve? How would it replace? What would it look like? You know, how would it work within that? Okay, Manuel's saying, in fact, holographs are used right now for companies meeting without physically attending. Okay, that's an interesting other use of technology. We're not talking AI there, but he's talking about kind of, instead of a Zoom or Skype meeting or something, holographic meetings, so you feel like you're in the room with somebody. Okay.
Yeah, maybe like, for example, a teacher is projected into a class and then gives a lesson in that kind of way through holographic teaching.
Mm-hmm. Jorge's got a very good point here that we're going to come to this as well, because that's another point to consider. Jorge's saying, I work in a rural institution. It's difficult for me because I only have a whiteboard and books. Very good point. Very important point. We'll talk about that in a moment as well when we get to get on from there. Let's see. I'm still looking for a really good example of how it would work. Okay. Well, let's move on to another question and see if that gets people going. Okay. Now, remember the original question, the original statement was that human teachers in school classrooms will become unnecessary. Is this a positive development? Okay. Now, many of you, as we said, have said, yes, it will happen, or it will happen partly. Is it a good thing or a bad thing? Okay, so let's talk about that. Neeraj, what would you say about this? How could we build on this?
Well, thinking about what could be the consequences or the repercussions for different groups of people in this context. So I would think about, well, if technology is replacing human teachers, who's that going to impact on? So obviously the teachers, they won't have jobs anymore. Is that a good thing? Or is it a bad thing if all these teachers don't have jobs anymore? Does that mean that they can go and do different jobs or work in another way? Or do they just not have any jobs anymore? And what about the students? Is it good for them mm-hmm. to not have human teachers or not? And why not? Why would it be good or bad for them not to have human teachers? Mm-hmm.
Julia's raised a good example or suggestion of why it might be bad. Studies have suggested that AI will most probably have a tendency to create misinformation and no way of human capabilities. So there's an issue, isn't it, that you could expand on? I mean, assume that you're learning from an app or something and that you're learning stuff like that, but actually the information is not correct.
Mm.
Okay. Hold on.
And I think her point about the human capability is also very important, like learning how to collaborate and interact with other people, socialization. I think that's another thing that teachers always talk about, teamwork, and making teams and directing those teams. That's part of the job of a teacher. Could a machine do it? Could a piece of software do it?
Mm-hmm. Libera is saying, for example, a general lesson plan or grading, but merely as a way of counting the mistakes made by the students. I'm not sure if this is a positive or negative, but I think possibly a positive. Possibly it's saying a time-saving thing or something like that.
But... Yeah. So it's a good thing from a teacher's perspective if they get to save time not correcting lots and lots of student work.
Mm-hmm. Alicia's saying it'd be bad because not everybody would find AI helpful enough for them to learn what they need to know. Again, Alicia, it's a good point, a very good point, but I would urge you to just go one step further. And if you say that not everybody would find AI helpful, why? You know, in what way? How is that the case? Okay. Okay. Something just happened really strange. I'm sorry.
What's happened?
Facebook stopped our broadcast.
Oh.
I don't know why. Okay.
Still saying live in the top left.
Yeah, well, we're still going out on YouTube and maybe one other Facebook channel, but someplace it stopped. I don't know. So let us know. Let us know in the comments if you can still see us on Facebook, because something happened someplace that seems to have caused a problem, but I don't know what that is. Okay, that's never happened before. Apparently Facebook thinks we've done something wrong. That sometimes happens if you do things like play copyrighted music or videos or something.
Alicia's telling us she can see us. She's on Facebook.
Okay, that's good. So it's just one channel, but yeah. Someone has lost us somewhere, so I can't really say sorry to them because they can't see us, but never mind. Okay, just keeping going, let's move along quickly with this and say, are there some subjects that couldn't be taught through technology alone? You gave an excellent example earlier of learning the ukulele and learning the piano. These can be taught for sure at the moment by very good programs. But are there some subjects that people watching think could never be taught by technology alone or just couldn't? Why? What are they? And why those subjects could not be taught by technology. What do you think, Neeraj? Any help you want to give people?
I think back to my school days, and I remember a class that I enjoyed immensely, which was pottery. You know, working with clay and making pots and little sculptures and things like that out of clay. I don't know if that could be taught by some kind of artificial intelligence or some kind of technology. That's really hands-on. But perhaps it can be through some combination of video, through some combination of some cameras that look at your work and then tell you if it needs to be improved in some way. I don't know. I can't say for sure,
mm-hmm.
but maybe some kind of subject like that, Or perhaps there's something, there's another subject that has a lot of human input or requires a lot of human output.
Mm-hmm. Libera has made a suggestion, art, which is, you know, because it requires a very personal approach. Okay. Miriam's got another suggestion, which is philosophy. It's interesting. I mean, that's, yeah. At the moment, I mean, AI could probably help you with input a great deal with teaching or helping you to understand philosophers' ideas and to perhaps, you know, summarize them or make them, you know, clearer in some ways or compare them. But then what? I guess many of us think, you know, then how do you take it to the next level to then apply them or perhaps and discuss them and work with that? So Andy saying medicine, that's an interesting one. Why do you think that, so Andy? What is it about medicine that you think technology alone could not teach? Okay. A lot of people are saying that. Medicine and biology, chemistry we have in there as well.
Alexander Vladimirov saying an elementary school cannot start from AI. That's a good point. Why not?
I mean, we've seen it in science fiction movies, certainly, but, you know, is it actually possible? Interesting. Miriam, again, journalism. Okay, so journalism, philosophy, music, painting, psychology, all of these things people are saying could not be taught through technology alone. Now, I don't know. I mean, you know, I'm in the middle here about all of this, but I'm sure there are probably some people who believe that they could be taught by AI. So if you're saying they can't, then, you know, let's think about the reasons and maybe explain what it is about those subjects that make it impossible for it to be taught only.
Deirdre's made a nice point there. Deirdre, yeah. About what about PE classes? Well, during the pandemic, my wife took up these online fitness classes, which are all on a computer, and you select the exercise on a piece of software, and it tracks the exercises you do. And I can see that being delivered by a piece of technology. Mm-hmm. But people have to make those videos, so I don't know.
Yeah, we're getting some really great ideas coming in there. You know, I mean, Shruti again is going, you know, but the, related to human technology, emotions can't be taught by technology. Uday is saying trade courses, you know, skills can't be taught by online. They really need a skilled professional. So it's talking about, you know, the personal expertise and so on, and, you know, the knowledge that someone's gained from a lifetime.
Interesting. Yeah, I guess kind of every problem is unique, and so it needs somebody to explain how to fix those kind of problems, maybe.
I have two answers here that go together. This would be a great, if we could have a classroom discussion here, it would be fantastic. Because Suwandi is saying, we need to practice in the final year using a human dead body. That's true at the moment, if we're talking about medicine. But then, as Darren says, AI can enhance with VR, with virtual reality operations, which can reduce mistakes in real operations. Perhaps we'll get to a point where we can use, you know, virtual reality and won't need a real, in the metaverse, as everyone's talking about. So lots of great answers, lots of great ideas. I think people would have no problems looking at this, I think, in coming up with a good essay. But the challenge still is getting these things together into the plan. One last question, because that goes back to what we spoke about earlier. Really important point. We're talking about this, replacing teachers. Will all students be able to use the technology? We had an example earlier from a teacher who works in a rural school with just a whiteboard and books. Those students perhaps, you know, couldn't possibly have access. What about this, Neeraj?
So here we're thinking about why replacing teachers with technology might not be a positive development. And one of the reasons could be that not all students will have access to the technology that allows them to receive those kind of lessons. And as our friend who's contributed here told us he works in a rural school where they just have whiteboards and pens, and they don't have tablets and they don't have cameras and they don't have a lot of technology around them, maybe not even an internet connection. So how would they be, teachers there be able to be replaced with technology? They wouldn't. You would need a physical teacher there.
Yeah.
And you could think of other situations where technology wouldn't work.
Mm-hmm. So that's another, I mean, again, if you were building a paragraph to talk about the reasons why it's not a good idea or why it would not be a positive development, you know, that's great. So we've looked at, you know, some of the aspects to do with what can teachers do that technology can't and so on. But access, like you say, whether people can actually use the technology or whether it means some people can't is another important point. Okay, great. We're running out of time now, so let's just let's move on to our last part. Bear with me. Okay.
So, yeah, everything we've done up to now has been thinking about what we're going to put in our essay, what we're going to develop.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're coming on to the structure, how we're going to organize the different bits of the essay. And yeah, you're going to say something, Neil?
No, I was going to say, so this is a suggestion, isn't it? I mean, we're not saying that this is the only way to organize this essay, but this is a suggestion that people watching can work from and try to fit the ideas that they've all spoken about, because they've all had excellent ideas into. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you want to talk them through this?
Yeah, this is a very basic, I call it a skeleton of a plan, which works very generally for most people. Four paragraphs. All essays need an introduction to tell the reader or the examiner what the essay is going to be about and the objective of the essay. And then two body paragraphs examining different aspects of the topic. And then finally, a conclusion that tells the reader again what you've talked about, and it restates your opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like a sandwich where the beginning and the end talk about the question and in general terms, and then the middle bit goes into the detail.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, this is a nice plan. I mean, I like the way that it takes you through this. First of all, you know, with the introduction, of course, we'll talk about that in another workshop later, but you know, the introduction has its role, gets you into the topic. But then, you know, people have been answering lots of great reasons about this, about whether it will or will not replace teachers, and what the you know, why that is the case, and why it might not be, and what the negative things are. So you've got, by the time you get to this point in the essay, you've got a nice understanding of the topic, a nice kind of feel for what the issues are, and then you go on to answer the second part of the question.
That's right. When you're up to here, you're really in a good place to write quite a lot and quite quickly, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, and as it says there, what we've just been speaking about, why it'd be a good or bad thing, examples, one or two examples of what it would involve, the positive, negative results. And like you did earlier with your ukulele, this is a great place to perhaps add in a personal example as well within that, from personal experience. Okay, so that's the plan. We're going to leave you with that plan. You can go back and have a look at it. It'd be great if any of you want to actually write an essay and share it in the comments. That would be great. We'd love to see one. You don't need to do the introduction and the conclusion, but you know, maybe you can do a paragraph covering some of the excellent points that you've made here, and just post it into the comments and we can have a look. And we're just going to leave you finally with some tips that Neeraj is going to talk you through, and then we're going to end for the day.
Yeah, so this is your step-by-step strategy of how to attack a question when you see it on an exam, or you see it in your exercise book, your textbook. First, take a deep breath and read the question. Remember to identify the topic and the task. Mark the keywords. Second, think about how you feel about the question. Are you in the no camp, the yes camp, or are you in the middle? Then you're thinking about what you're going to write about, your main ideas. So if the essay, like we said, our essay is about human teachers being unnecessary, well, we're going to start thinking about WH questions to interrogate those points, to develop them. Then step four is to start to think about which order we want to put all those ideas in, to make them into a logical sequence, to give it a structure, and group together things which are connected into paragraphs.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, it's to build the main points into complete paragraphs. So it's not just stating an idea,
yeah,
but saying a bit more and saying why you think that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think that's great. Yeah, because we had lots of ideas today, but a lot of them, as you said, were statements. And you know, exactly, you want to avoid that. You want to avoid, I think you mentioned at the very beginning of today's class, shopping list.
Yeah.
You want to avoid that, and you want to just focus on one or two ideas and really develop them for that. And that's where this comes in. Okay, that's great. I just want to leave with one last comment, and then we're done. Furlitz is saying, on this topic, a teacher doesn't teach only maths or language or some other lessons. A teacher teaches his or her students the human principles with his or her personal example. Okay, so that's something you could definitely incorporate in your essay for that. I think we're done now for the day. I think that was good. I hope this was useful for you. We'll be back again next week to follow on from this. We're going to look at other parts of writing an essay, putting it together, introductions, conclusions, and so on, all the different parts you need. And, you know, by the end of it, hopefully we'll have you writing lots of examples.
That's okay. Right. This is just the beginning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Last words before we just go, I just want to say goodbye.
Thanks for everybody. Thanks to everybody who's joined us. And look forward to more sessions where we'll be looking at writing essays in more detail, all the other bits of an essay. So see you then.
Yeah. See you next week. Okay. Bye for now.
Bye.